Well, welcome back to Engaging India at Almedalen Week here on Gotland. Our focus on this session is collaborations towards accelerating attainment of our global sustainable development goals. Global partnerships are a key goal in sustainable development. Multi-stakeholder partnerships among countries, communities, and people among different industries and academia are important when we are talking about issues of access, when we are talking about innovation, and when we are talking about equity. Now, as the recent COVID-19 pandemic showed, we cannot achieve sustainable development goals in silos. Strong global partnerships are needed. People, industry, and nations must collaborate. They must co-create and cooperate as partners to ensure that innovative and sustainable development impacts all of humankind in a positive manner. The question then we are exploring today is, how can Sweden and India partner towards achieving these global goals? And how can Sweden and India collaboratively set an example and show the way for others? Before I introduce our speakers for the panel debate and begin the discussion, let's first head to New Delhi, from where the Ambassador of Sweden to India, His Excellency Klas Moulin, has sent us this opening address. He recorded it on the eve of Almedalen Week. We'll try and play it. We've had a bit of a tech challenge here in Sweden, but let's see if it works.
Hello, everyone. Participating yet again at Almedalen, albeit in a virtual way. I'm very happy to be with you and to talk about Sweden's and India's bilateral and multilateral cooperation. Engaging India at Almedalen, I was wondering for a second whether engaging here was to be seen as a verb or an adjective. Both indeed are possible. The theme this year is one of interconnectedness, of transboundary challenges and opportunities and mutual dependencies. And I feel that our bilateral and multilateral cooperation addresses this head on. It's very much at the center of our relations. We have a joint action plan, we have a joint innovation partnership. And the joint innovation partnership is very much about promoting innovation, obviously, for a sustainable future. And it's linked, as you know, I'm sure, to the sustainable development goals. It's also something that's been confirmed at every opportunity since the partnership was signed over four years ago in Stockholm during Prime Minister Modi's visit at that time. It's been confirmed at virtual meetings, at the summit level, most recently in Copenhagen, when the Prime Minister came for the second ever Indo-Nordic summit, as well as a number of bilateral meetings with the heads of government, heads of state and government of the Nordic countries. Also after these partnerships were agreed, we've taken a number of other initiatives together. Sweden and India formed the leadership group for industry transition. We have also joined the International Solar Alliance. And I think it's safe to say that together we've also explored the triple helix model, something that we hold very dear and something that's very much part and parcel of Sweden's innovation policy. Essentially, it's found that only by using all resources of society is it possible to get a broad buy-in and also acceptance for reform, for creative and forward-looking policies. It's also a wonderful way of encouraging and channeling new ideas and solutions. So I think generally, we've seen that by creating and sustaining a truly enabling environment, we can encourage and foster innovation and creativity. One of the best ways that we feel we're doing this together is through mutual funding of projects and proposals that are meant to improve and make our lives greener, more sustainable. And right now, thanks to the foresight and funding of our governments, we have a jointly funded call out for proposals on circular economy, with 9 funding agencies engaged, participating on in both Sweden and India. This initiative, this call, follows a great number of earlier calls on innovation in the science and technology field, and I know there will be many more to follow. Finally, I think it's important also to mention another group in the and another sector in this important triple helix, sometimes quadruple helix if you talk about civil society as well, other than government, business, academia, and civil society. And that is precisely what I just mentioned, business. Our business community is a very strong and inspiring resource as we try to go green and sustainable. I think they clearly see that it's also in their interest to be out front and center. And so they're participating right now in a sustainability mapping that the embassy, our consulate general in Mumbai, as well as our Chamber of Commerce is undertaking. We look very much forward to seeing the results of this. Some early takes are already out, very promising to see how these companies are going greener and greener and how, again, they're engaging not just their own staff, but also the societies in which they are active in promoting greener and more sustainable policies and business practices. So, as you know, there are no shortages here, no shortage of examples, and we look forward to seeing and hearing about many, many more. Good luck with the session. Enjoy Gotland, Visby, Almedalen, and, of course, also Uppsala campus. Thank you very much for listening.
Right, and we begin the discussion now. I'm going to head first and invite our virtual speakers. So we have with us Per-Arne Wikström. He's the head of Office of Science and Innovation at the Embassy of Sweden, New Delhi. Also joining us virtually from India is Viral Thakkar, a Deloitte South Asia lead and partner who looks after strategy, AI, analytics, merger and acquisitions with a focus on sustainability and climate change. Also joining us is Sujit Nair. He heads the Beckon Foundation and works very closely on open innovation and iStack and looking at technology and open source technology for a sustainable future. I'd like to also invite our guests who are here on Gotland personally during Almedalen week. May I please invite Raine Saxon, docent and associate professor, Uppsala University, with a focus on sustainability management and quality for sustainability, just some of the things which you are researching on. Also joining me here in person is Erik Gutvarsa, Division President, Nordics and Baltics, MasterCard. Welcome. And Joachim Lindbore, a CTO, Sustainable Innovation, which works to link innovative enterprises and startups with larger platforms. Welcome, Joachim. We will later on have a session wrap up with two of the co-organizers of Engaging India at Almedalen, which I will introduce them a little later. But let's get started straight away with the questions. Going to India first, since there are our guests that are far away. Let's start with you, Viral. If we are to really look at sustainable development goals, then the partnerships for global goals is a very crucial SDG. SDG number 17. Now, I do know that you at Deloitte have been creating a lot of impact at the ground level. Perhaps you can share with us on the initiatives that you are involved in, both for the climate as well as for the other sustainable development goals like healthcare, no poverty, etc.
Thank you so much for that, and good afternoon to all of everyone who's with us in person and virtually. And it's my honor to be here to be a part of this conversation. Before I talk about the work that Deloitte's been doing, I thought I'll just frame this in the context of why the developing countries such as India, and how does that play into what's relevant globally? So the approach that that countries like India have and are thinking, at least from a Deloitte perspective, has been that in order to meet our global goals, be it SDG or even net zero, et cetera, it's important to make sure that the developing countries get there as well. Why? Because, this is a great opportunity to build things right rather than having to retrofit later, mm-hmm. right? So that's the thinking that we have.
Right.
And where the broad partnership between countries and companies may come into place is that markets such as India provide the scale. So you have the 1.4 billion people, and that's true with other developing markets as well, but not necessarily the ability to buy solutions at a cost in the developed markets, right? So can we scale some of the innovations and provide a great test bed in some other developing markets? So that's the thesis. Now, what are some of the initiatives that we are piloting? So the thinking that we have is that if we as Deloitte, in partnership with other private sector organizations and local governments, can build pilot solutions around some of the areas, then they can then, assuming that we are able to prove their effectiveness, then they can be scaled up further, both for the benefit of other states in India, as well as other developed markets and developing markets. So just to give you some examples, we are running a number of pilot programs, one of them being to mitigate the impact of stubble burning. I'm sure most of you know this, but stubble burning has a significant impact on the environment in North India. And Parane, you are based in Delhi, so I'm sure you see this firsthand. But in some months, it's as much as 40% of the particulate matter that's in the air. And we are working with in one of the states in one district to try and pilot solutions from startups. So there's a biochar startup called Takachar, which won the WWF Moonshot Prize. The Earthshot Prize. We are working with some local innovators to try and see if we could bring in more super seeders and balers to play. And we are building an Uberized platform to make the equipment available at the right time. And we believe that if some of these initiatives work, it'll hopefully make life easy in Delhi and other parts of North India. But not just India. It's also a problem that impacts Thailand, Indonesia, and Singapore. Right. Mm-hmm. So it'll actually something that could work in other countries as well. Similarly, we are working on another program to pilot different methods to scale afforestation using a public-private partnership model and allowing bringing in the local communities to try and see if they can earn a living out of the afforestation or the trees that will come in. And thereby bringing in a more sustainable ongoing process. And the reason this is important is all companies are looking to buy carbon credits and to offset some of their emissions. A program such as afforestation does generate those. And if we can use some of the financial benefits that come out of this into the communities, then this can become a self-sustaining exercise. So we are also bringing in an element of local community, and we are calling this team Climate Sakhis. Sakhi means a friend in Hindi.
Right.
So we are actually calling them Climate Sakhis, who will not only benefit from some of the agroforestry models, but also benefit the overall community. And I'll not belabor this, but there are other programs we are working on with for coastal erosion. On a maternal health program, as well as you may have heard of the Ocean Cleanup, which was a Dutch entrepreneur that founded this,
mm-hmm.
Boyan Slat. And that's something that we've also been supporting, and we'd like to do more of these programs in India and other parts of the world. Let me pause here and hand back to you, Rupali.
Well, very, very interesting initiatives, Viral, and thanks for sharing them. We do have some other players here who are working towards climate action. And perhaps I can throw it to you first, Eric, because you've been we've been having a lot of discussions on the kind of initiatives you have both in the Nordics, larger Baltics, as well as in other parts of the world. Could you share throw some light on that, please?
Absolutely, more than happy to. I think great initiatives overall, and thank you for sharing those. So I think the good thing is with innovation and companies like ourselves, like MasterCard, it's big global corporations overall. And what we can do is to leverage our global power that we are connecting 3 billion people out there and 100 million businesses out there, and leverage that network to actually scale things that we see is good. And they can be innovated here in Sweden, they can be innovated in India or innovated anywhere else. But the power of our network is that those great ideas we can leverage, and just what we heard here as well, really create scale. And that's, I think, is what it's all about.
Right.
And one of those examples is a company here, a local small company that is called Economy. So what they did was that they actually were sitting here now in the Baltic Sea. Baltic Sea is very polluted. There is an island, another island here, not Gotland, it's called Åland, that has a bank that calls Ålandsbanken. And what they saw was that this ocean is getting very, very polluted. We need to be able to do something about it. How can we as a bank do a difference here? And what they then found was that based on how you're using your card and how you're spending, you can get your carbon footprint. And based on your carbon footprint, you can then get an understanding of how your behaviors are actually changing the environment overall. So they adopted that instead of loyalty program and bonus programs and so on the card. And that was something later on that we saw, this is great, let's scale that. So that is now part of our global offering as MasterCard, that everyone, the 3 billion people, as well as they get what they're paying, that it costs 100 euros, also the carbon footprint for those 100 euros. And I think those initiatives are extremely interesting, and therefore we have also decided to do more of those things and have started our global sustainability lab here in Sweden to actually scale and come up with new great innovations. And that is a global one. So we're very keen to work together. We work with the European Commission, with the Green Initiative, for example, but we're also very keen to work with India and other places around the world to really come up with those great ideas that we can scale and leverage the network effect overall on.
Right. It's interesting that you speak about two things here, about scale, and you're also speaking about the onus on the person, right? What their per capita consumption is and how it can be traced. And I will delve into that in just a bit, because we have somebody who really specializes on scale and open platforms in India. But Joachim, if I can bring you in, you are looking at micro energy systems, sort of looking at clean, sustainable microsystems, as well as looking at ways in which they can connect to the larger ecosystem. How do you go about that?
Well, in Sweden, we had the grid. We built the grid. We did it for so many years. So of course, we need to be on the grid. And everybody just used the grid as a copper plate. And that's what all the market in Sweden are about. We should be a big copper plate. You push in any energy and you pull it out anywhere. But suddenly we realized, oh, there is bottlenecks. We need to rebuild. And now it's huge. Oh, we need to rebuild the whole grid. But we could do more or less what Africa and India is doing, build it from the outside in.
Okay.
And we could do so much locally. So taking in knowledge from being local together with knowledge from doing everything big, that's where the new ignition is. Because if you have a island possible house that's helping the net on the grid, it's usually not having any power peaks at all. It's a very nice little house. And if there's a power peak and everything shut down, it works itself. So we have resilience, we have local possibilities, but we also have the sharing economy of making a big energy effort somewhere to move it out to every people. Mm-hmm. And that's the whole thing. When you can go with both local economy incentives together with a larger sharing economy, which is the energy grid is just a sharing economy, and everybody must be on it. Otherwise, you have energy poverty.
Right.
So if 13,000 people in California goes off grid, it's a disaster. But if they keep being on the grid, helping the ones that still are on the grid, then we have a nice prosperity.
That's a good example of a sharing economy. Go ahead, you were saying something else.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right, so Sujit, if I can bring you in, we are talking about a sharing economy. We are talking about also the possibility of an open source when you talk about sharing and collaboration. And how can we kind of co-think and co-create open source sharing economies towards achieving our sustainable development goals? So, and how does digital transformation kind of plug into this?
Thanks, Rupali. It's a great question, and it's fantastic to hear the views from all the speakers spoken before me. I think if you look at the problems that we are trying to solve towards, you know, whatever goals that we have defined as part of is, you know, sustainable development. I think the problems itself have this characteristic that one, they are constantly evolving, they are complex, and while at a global level, they are a common set of problems, more or less we're dealing with, whether it's a developing economy or a developed economy. But the underlying layers of this problem are complex and are very nuanced to a particular, either a regional or a cultural context. Mm-hmm. Now, I think that characterization of the problem is something that we've been recognizing for a while. And once you add scale to it, it becomes a problem of a gigantic proportion, right? And that's where the idea of solutions, I'm sure there are fascinating solutions that are coming in day in and out. And we just heard some of those examples. Really fascinating to see what's happening. But I think somewhere we need to recognize that a problem a solution may not be universal to every type of context where the problem we're dealing with, right? For the same problem, it could be different in Sweden and it could be different in a remote part in India. I think that is where I think the thinking that, you know, instead of looking at, hey, should we find one solution and have it, you know, adopted at many places? If we were to shift that narrative from, you know, taking this one solution to solving problem everywhere, to actually distributing the problem solving itself, instead of one person or one solution saying, I will solve the problem, can we distribute the ability to solve such that that ability is available at that particular place, context, to give a very contextually relevant solution? And this, not just do it contextually relevant at a particular place or in a cultural context, mm-hmm. but also do it at scale. Because what we're trying to do is not to create pocket solutions that work in one area, maybe one part of the country in India itself, and not relevant in the other part of the country. And that is where I think when you combine this contextual solutioning and distributing the ability to solve with scale, I think that's where technology, digital, can make a big difference. Now, unfortunately, the way digital, or if you look at the entire platform-based economies have been evolving, it has kind of become a very kind of a monolithic one solution trying to solve a problem. Whether it's a ride-hailing platform that works well in America, it may not necessarily work to solve the problem of mobility and sustainability in, say, India. And that is where I think somewhere technology took a very, very monolithic, almost like a cookie-cutter approach. But if you were to now think about saying, how do we make the digital itself reinvent the way it's designed, reinvent the way it creates this ability to distribute problem solving? And that is where open infrastructure, okay? We call it the digital public goods, the basic building blocks like the internet itself or the basic protocols, the building blocks of the internet itself. If we can create a very thin, non-rivalrous, non-exclusive digital public infrastructure that allows solution makers in different parts of the world to come up with contextually relevant solution rather than propagating one solution across the whole globe, that is possible with some basic foundational digital infrastructure. And the biggest example that we are all feeling, and the fact that we are having this conversation with me sitting in Bangalore, is because of internet. Internet, there's no better example than internet as a foundational digital infrastructure. I mean, just think for a moment that when internet was created as a sort of an evolution from packet switching, nobody was thinking at that time that one day it will be the host of largest content platform, travel platform, ride hailing platform, or a hotel platform. But today, because the purpose of internet was minimal and enabling, they could be innovators. They were innovators who came and solved for that. We have to replicate that pattern, especially for some of the large scale societal problems that we're dealing with as a spectrum of SDG. If we can create digital public infrastructure, which is as non-rivalrous, open, and inclusive, and I think that's a key word, if it's inclusive for any small business or a small solution maker to participate, be naturally discoverable, make your solution be accessible there, and solve for this significant access vector when it comes to access to opportunity, access to market, access to where the problems are, I think that's where digital can make difference, but the digital too in the right way, which is where this whole idea of open source protocols as digital public goods,
right.
Beacon is an example as a protocol, can enable that distributed problem solving, which kind of give a sustainable way to solve for the sustainable development goals.
So we've gone into a sort of a sharing economy, we've gone to scale, and we are looking at digital transformation. I'm going to get two more pieces into this quite a complex discussion. Let's first bring in the academic side of it. Raine is joining us. You have been very closely associated with studying sustainability, what it really means from an academic point of view, and also from an industry point of view, because you have sort of experience and expertise from both sides. Now, how can we bring in the academia and the tremendous research that is done in universities and such learning institutions into practical applications that the other gentlemen here are talking about? And then I will come to Triple Helix, which Per Arne will tell me about. Yeah.
Well, it's quite a big question, but I think academia sometimes is a bit slow. And then it's quite known that we like to focus on research, and that empirical and practical parts are sometimes considered as a nuisance. But I think Uppsala University, being the oldest one in Sweden, they actually redesigned their goals, I think it's 3 years ago, where it used to be said world-class research is an analysis, relevant world-class research. So it's a step forwards. There is somebody who needs that research. They are kind of a customers, those that need it. And so I think they've started also a sustainability project trying to actually understand what it is. And I can't contribute so much to digitalization, but it's more this of trying to understand what actually sustainability and sustainable development is. And my background is in quality management. And that can be hard enough when you hear politicians here say, oh, we want quality in the school, and we want things. So what are we talking about? And that's difficult. But when you take it to sustainability, it's like one magnitude more. Then we all like hearing that it should be sustainable, but we think about different things. So with our students, we tried this, I think suggested the contextualization and taking it from the outside in. So what is actually the main problems? I mean, the 17 goals there, it could be a little bit of putting the cart in or the horse, the cart in front of the horse, that you go looking for it. Instead, you should, in the context, try to understand yourself which are the main sustainability impacts that we have. And then you need to define that for your own organization. There can be absolutely no general solution for that, but you need to go with it. And I'll just take an example. Two years ago with a PhD student, we said, okay, we want to look at building sustainability. I mean, building is a basic thing. Everybody needs that. And it stands for maybe 30% of the carbon emissions in the world. Mm. So then the question is, so what is sustainable building? You think, how difficult can that be? And we looked at, I think, 23 different sustainability reports, trying to find out, have they tried to define what sustainable development is? And in most cases, the answer is no. And when there was that definition, then it was kind of a fluffy and didn't actually help you much. I think, and last year I was on a distance conference, and I asked the sustainability director of one of the big building companies on a chat, and so, and he said, so what is sustainable development for you? And he goes, and then comes some blah, 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 which didn't actually tell us very much. And so what we did instead, we said, okay, but really, what are the main problems in building? So what could sustainable building be? And now we're talking from raw materials, from cradle to grave. So all the kind of a life cycle, you build the house, you use it, you demolish it, and you reuse it. So what could be important? Well, obviously, it has to be climate neutral. Otherwise, it's not sustainable. Mm. But it has to be affordable. It doesn't help if it's too expensive. So it has to be. So sustainable building should at least be climate neutral and affordable. And then you can use that definition and you can look at the different processes, like where I've been working in cement manufacturing, and say, what does that then mean? Mm. But when you look at sustainability reports, it's not there. It's more about, I mean, I agree that we need to work with actions, but working with the right actions is even better. So you need to understand this so you don't miss the main points. And there, the 17 goals, they could be a little bit of a confusion. So you need to understand that this is kind of a checklist. And then you need to pick what's relevant for you. Climate would always be that, but then there may be other things, like I think poverty comes in with, especially building in developing countries. That's a main concern for most people. Mm-hmm. So trying to bring the understanding from outside in and going to the practices of it. So what's sustainable building? What's sustainable tourism? Is there sustainable fashion? And the company that works with it needs to think it through, which is not happening today very much. It's like you tell about all the nice actions you do, but you don't tell how the company should be when they are to become sustainable.
So it's about what you're touching upon is also about measuring sustainability in sort of a more correct way than what we do as of now.
I think like Eric mentioned, if people get that feedback directly, it's very important. And it is hard. Today you get many measurements, but quite often they are not accurate. And, where at least there are measures to be found is like for the climate, which was one of the existential issues. Mm-hmm. But you still can see, I think when we looked at here with students on sustainability reports, about 20% of the companies would actually report for their carbon emissions in the entire value chain, and 80 would not. So my favorite kind of object, all the food shops, or the wholesalers like ICA, Coop, Willys, they would, at least when I looked last time, when they say, are we going to be carbon neutral? What does it mean? They mean that their shop is going to be carbon neutral. They're still going to buy a lot of food products from the agriculture, which is a humongous. That's not in the calculations. And one of the chains, they say, we produce 1 million krona of value for 1 ton of carbon dioxide. That's a lie, because when you look at the value chain, it's 25,000. Because you have all, I mean, as a customer, of course, I want to know, I'm not interested how much does the shop contribute. I'm interested in what does the product. If I buy a liter of milk, what is the carbon footprint of that?
I think today it's difficult to find. Eric wants to jump into that on the consumer angle. That, you know, sort of how can I kind of pitch in and bring in that? Oh, we have a solution now.
We unfortunately don't have the perfect solution yet, but we're working on it, because. I think I fully agree with you. I think the more, and the way we're doing this as well, is that I think now it's not about competing. It's not that we should have our index, Visa should have theirs, Swish here should have theirs. It's about opening up and finding one index that is as good as possible. And that's what is good as possible. And I know that, for example, what we're doing currently is that what we're basing it on is just that every time you use your card, we know whether it's a restaurant, whether it is a clothing store, whether it is an airline that you're shopping at, and so on. But so that's the highest level. And that can give the foundation and the baseline for everyone, because most people don't know if spending 100 kroners for clothes or 100 kroners on an airline, what it's worth. And at least that's established that one. But then it really comes down to then preferably getting to those 20% of the companies that actually report it. Then you can look at, actually, then you can have competitive advantage whether you're ICA or Axfood, if they would report it correctly. And then they can have a competitive advantage versus themselves. Then preferably we go down to line item. We go down to that meat, if you're buying meat, for example, and should have a full value chain. that is then becoming quite difficult. We have done it, for example, for shrimps, you know, those big shrimps that are very bad for the environment, how you can track them using blockchain technology so you can really see that they are environmental friendly or not. So there are technologies out there, but it quite easily becomes quite complex. So I think we need to take it stepwise and then developing it further all the time and learn from each other and work with academia and work with everyone together to create this as one unified system. And if we can leverage different type of platforms coming together, the only thing, it needs to be standard in one way. We need to be comparable, and that is not that easy.
Yeah, we're talking about standards. This is very interesting, and I'm really wanting to get Pararne in, but you've raised your hand, so go ahead.
Because Coop, have you seen their spider diagrams? Yeah. Are they part of this standardization, or is that just one silo of an idea?
That is one silo of ideas.
That's one silo of the idea, because they had 10 different sustainable goals that are measuring like a spider diagram. Yeah. That's on all subjects in the stores.
Yeah.
So we need to join them.
Talking about measurement, actually, I'm going to ask that question to Viral, because he can provide an excellent view on that from the Asian perspective, for example. Viral, without going into too much technicalities, we were talking about, you know, how does one have a standardization of measurement, for example? There is a lot that is being done here in the Nordics when one is talking about measuring either, you know, GHGs or we are talking about measuring different kinds of carbon emissions and other global greenhouse emissions. But in India, how are you seeing industry react to it? Since you all engage with a lot of industry on initiatives that can kind of help different sustainability goals, not just climate action or carbon, but how are you seeing the industry engage as a whole?
Good question. So, Rupali, the way I see it, India now has a regulation that requires the top 1,000 companies to file on an annual basis what is called the BRSR report. So these are the largest 1,000 companies. They are now required to file. It is, so BRSR is business reporting and sustainability report. So business sustainability reporting. And what's important is it has most of the elements of what we might consider part of ESG. So companies are now being asked to report on not just their broad framework and approach, but also their spend and their emissions and so on. Where there is still a slight gap is the impact side of things, which is if you are spending money on a CSR program, what is the practical value you've delivered? And when I say value, I mean outcome or achievements, right? Most of the measurement is based on the input metrics, which is I spent so many million rupees or billion rupees, rather than what I spent resulted in an X percent improvement of farmer incomes or education levels or improvement in standardized test scores and so on. So it's that standardized measurement that's probably a missing area, but the broad reporting framework is now in place. And I believe that, sooner or later, as, you know, maybe through the foundational, the foundational digital infrastructure approach that Sujit described, but also from, private enterprise, such as the example from MasterCard, maybe some of those examples do need to come in where private sector will start to voluntarily publish that. In fact, we have been working with a number of the standards bodies to try and articulate the circularity and some of this reporting is also becoming relevant, but it's not standardized. I must admit that's something that's still an open or an unfinished agenda.
So that's very interesting to hear. And Pararne, I'm coming to you now. In many ways, when I'm coming to you, we're kind of zooming out because You are looking at science and innovation and sustainability and climate action and looking at ways in which Sweden and India can cooperate on this. There are a number of initiatives that have already started in two very different regions talking to each other towards a better planet. Could you share with us some of those?
Yes, of course. Thank you for inviting me here. It's been really exciting to listen to you. I lost the connection for a little while, so I missed some of it, but everything I've heard has been really, really interesting. So I would actually begin with, let's put the action plans and activities aside for a little while and just focus on, since you said, let him zoom out a little. And I would like to do that because I think that there is an urgency actually in Europe, in the US and other areas where we are really focusing on innovation and research-driven innovation and development to change our mindset when it comes to India. For instance, I don't know how many people attend this seminar digitally or in place in Visby, but I no matter how many people you would say are there, I would say it's way too few. People don't know what's going on in India at the moment. And I would actually, if I got more time, I would also argue that in India, people don't understand that because it's moving so fast. The first time I visited India was in 1989 as a young student in business administration. I didn't care about India as a business platform or anything. I just wanted to see Taj Mahal and visit all the scenic places, and I sure did, and now I'm back working here. Everything has changed. India is still known for the culture and the heritage and maybe Bollywood, you know, and cricket and things like that, but it's not what's going on in India. India is going to be an economic superpower. If you look at the areas where I work with the unique startups, the innovation, infrastructure, it's booming. And I used to work a lot with China in the early 2000s, and I can see exactly the same thing that happened in China now going on in India. I noticed, just as an example, that India had 41 unicorns last year, and now already it's 100. Europe has got 300 unicorns, I think. So there is something going on in India, and I would say that the most important thing when it comes to working on these issues, sustainability-related issues that engage innovation and development, has to do with mindsets. India will have a growing role when it comes to sustainability. I think that when it comes to Sweden and India, we have a really beautiful platform to begin with. We have in 2018, as Ambassador Molin said, we have this strategic partnership for a sustainable future. So we have a political push towards everyone working within these questions to really do things. And as you also said, Rupali, we have a number of different activities going at the moment. We have this activity where we have research and innovation, this call on circular economy. Klaus said we have 9 funding agencies from Sweden and India. That is never heard of. You know, my European friends in New Delhi, they just wonder, how are you doing this? But I think this is something that we have to do. It's really urgent to develop not only new ideas, but also to develop the way we innovate and develop things together. And Sweden, being one of the most prominent innovation countries, we have to be in India because of the booming environment that is there. We have, I can just mention two other activities that we are engaged in at the moment. We had meetings today on that. And that one is linking the Swedish innovation system with the Indian innovation system. So in India, there is an activity going on trying to map and also to organize all these incubators and innovation hubs nationally. And what we are doing here is that we're adding Sweden as one of these hubs. So, and that is something that you will notice in the near future. We are also working on researcher mobility, facilitating researcher exchange, because I think, I really truly believe that it has to do with, as we've heard here, people need to meet people. And you have exactly the skill, the same skilled people in India as you would find in Sweden. I've been visiting numerous now incubators in India, and I can tell you, I've seen many of them in Sweden. It's the same people. You know, you have the really focused, talented young people, a bit nerdy because they are so engaged in their specific topic. Most of it is related to sustainability activities. And the only thing we need to do is to connect these people and support the connectivity. And that's what we are doing. But as I said, going back to what I began with, I think we would need to have, I mean, it's so important, it's so big, that was what is going on now. So we would need to have an Almedalen India, you know, it's that size of it. We would need to do much more, having much more people engaged in this, because they still, it's a lot of people in Sweden, business people, still think that India is not where it is today.
Right, and we'll take up on that idea, Pararne, on a bigger engaging India at Almedalen, and next year, you know, having you here as well, giving us another update on what's really happening between India and Sweden. But you did raise some very interesting points on the fact that there are several innovation and research organizations, ecosystems, and agencies that are working together already between Sweden and India on sustainability issues. And perhaps let's ask sort of the Indian side on how interested they would be. Is it something that they would like to engage with? Does it excite them? Viral and Sujit, perhaps coming to you first, Viral.
I'll keep it short. I think the short answer is yes, there would be significant interest in collaborating, both India as a test bed for some of the innovation, or even a market, but also as a talent base to support some of the global innovation. So I would say in both ways.
Sujit?
No, absolutely. I agree with Viral, and I think that collaboration is very vital. And I think from an India point of view, that kind of participation in discussions with a Swedish community, as you know, Pranay mentioned, would be very useful, because sometimes I do see sometimes that we probably take a scale bit too seriously in India, because we easily have 1.4 billion people. So we said, okay, whatever we do, we touch 1.4 billion people. But sometimes it doesn't really mean that solution, if it works for 1.4 billion in India, it could work in other economies too. So that's where I think that whole perspective to look at problems beyond a time scale and look at contextually relevance, and that, mm-hmm. that dialogue is very important. And we are seeing that already. I mean, the community that we have around this open source protocol backend, we are getting participation from Norway, Amsterdam, and a few other places where there are individuals contributing, the same nerdy type that Asparane mentioned, contributing and saying, hey, why don't we do this differently? Why are we not looking at approaches which are very different from what probably you are seeing as the most relevant in India? And I think those conversations are enriching, and it makes it more sort of relevant to a wider context. And I think sometimes that is something that goes missing if you're just caught up in one ecosystem and thinking and solving for one ecosystem all the time.
Yeah. Interesting. You talk about one ecosystem. We're talking about sort of different specializations and verticals. So I'm going to sort of broad base it a little more and talk about something which I first heard when I came here to Sweden, when I moved here, and that's the triple helix, sort of the intersection and how academia, industry, and governments, and perhaps the ambassador also brought in the quadruple helix about civil society or communities coming together and working together, working for the planet. How does the triple helix really work? Sweden first. Sorry, Raine?
How it works? I'm not sure how it works, but how it could work. And in Sweden, we say that university has three tasks. It's carrying out research, it's doing education based on research, and it's cooperate with society. And I think all those parts, I can see that there's a trend of strengthening them. Mm-hmm. That goes together with the relevance. So I think getting more going in there where actually you try to see how well is this education landing into the needs of the employers, how is research actually being into actions, and how is this cooperation leading to some real results with sustainability.
Any examples of how you've seen it work? Yeah, go ahead, Joachim.
Well, I would say it doesn't work.
Oh, it doesn't work, yeah. Okay.
I would say that there's a lot of helixes on the sides, and they would like to work together. And we're doing it. We're trying to get Vinnova to finance a project from the doctoral PhD person. And then there's an innovator trying to get money from the funding agency. And there's social parts trying to get the money. But there's no driver. They have their own agendas. The innovator should never create a project. They should
do the
innovation.
So then who's the driver?
Thing.
How do we create the driver?
You need a project leader. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You need the one that takes these four, asks for the money, and then drives the project to the goal. And that's what we do with sustainable innovation, trying the project into the area.
So perhaps we can get the Office of Science and Innovation to be one of the drivers, and then Viral's organization to be one of the drivers, Eric's organization to be one of the drivers. Would that work? Viral?
Again, great debate. I think the private sector or the industry has the unique ability to take significant risks in the sense that a project could fail and that would be okay. Mm-hmm. So the bets that a large organization can take on an innovator or a startup is reasonably strong, right? So that's the ability that a larger organization such as ourselves, MasterCard, and others can take. Mm-hmm. But you're right. If there was a way to, if there was an idea that was presented or a project that was created, it would be much easier to evaluate, right? Piloting those, possible. Taking bets, possible. But we need a forum to bring these ideas to the front to be able to say, what is it that we are trying to solve?
Right. Any words on that, Eric? And then I'm going to ask Parardne.
Absolutely. I think there is a great collaboration that could happen, because I think overall we know payments, and only in payments it's happened more in the last 5 years than it has in our history of 50 years. So just keeping up with that is quite a lot. And then the sustainability angle, we're not experts in that. Mm-hmm. So we need someone that is expert in that. So if we can leverage academia in that, or smart fintechs that comes up with a little bit what we would see initially as crazy ideas, I think that's what we need to do. We need to collaborate and have all parties sitting together doing that. And that's where we can work, and as we heard here as well, and other big corporates, like we have, for example, our Lighthouse program and StartPath program, where we are collecting startups, the governmental entities, mm-hmm. academia, as well as ourselves, as well as our partners, the banks and others, teaming them up and seeing how we can contribute with each individual part and bringing that together to create value. Because we need to complement each other, and we cannot be best at everything. But if we complement each other in a great way, we can get much faster to the end goal.
This is interesting. Parardne, can you... there are challenges, of course. Joachim did mention the challenge of the lack of a driver. How does, say, the Office of Science and Innovation look for the driver or become the driver or get together people in which a triple helix or a quadruple helix can really work? And My second question, of course, which I'm going to throw to all of you all, and that would be kind of my final question, is that do we need to change mindsets? Is the mindset of failing fast, should it be more accepted than it is currently? Pararne, take the first shot, please.
Okay, so first of all, you know my answer on mindsets, so I don't need to talk about more about that. I think it's urgent and it needs to be changed. When it comes to triple helix or multiple helix approaches, I would actually argue that Sweden is one of the best countries in the world when it comes to that. We have a long tradition, and you can see it in a country like India. We have all the large companies in Sweden that work in India, they are really focusing on those kind of issues. So there is a presence and a lot of activities in India from Swedish large companies. I'm more critical, or I can see much more challenges when it comes to startups, smaller companies, and mm-hmm. How they can interact with Indian stakeholders. So there we have a challenge, and I think in that sense, our little office at the embassy, of course, we can do a lot of things, but I also think that our role is more to facilitate collaboration, matchmaking, support of different measures taken by investors, innovators, incubators from both countries. And I can see a lot of things happening. We would need to do more, of course, as mm-hmm. as always. So I think that would be my input into that question.
Right. Sujit? Change in mindset, failing fast, yes, trying out different things, talking to each other.
Yes, I think two quick comments. I think one, I think it's probably, I think the issues, I think we're looking at triple helix because somewhere we are sharing some competencies, mutually sharing competencies to solve a problem. But I think it's always bereft with problems of, you know, who's taking the burden, what is the incentives, and of course the mindset, as Piana very, very, very nicely articulated. I think until we go through those barriers, I think it will be an issue. So we need to find a way to define a very specific sort of a challenge, which and the right set of an incentive structure. It may not be a financial incentive or any kind of an incentive, but maybe the incentive structure to make it more participatory and voluntary. I think that is key. The second message is, I think it's probably not triple, but quadruple. I think in India, we call it the different kind of a triple helix. We call it the Samaj Sarkar Bazaar, which is the civil society, government, and the bazaar being market. But I think if I were to add academia into it, it's actually quadruple. And I feel that I think if you're solving for these problems as a triple helix for the civil society, for the larger sort of population, I think they should be a participant too. I think that participation is very important. And you never know what kind of solutions that emerge when they are also participating in the dialogue, because suddenly you may probably see very viable incentive, viable motivations, and an opportunity to quickly do something and probably build from there. I think that's one of the things that you may want to be focused on, as to how do we get this. And just a very quick example on that, we're trying to do this for solving for this mobility problem in India, and we have a city where the taxi drivers with probably no technology competency have created sort of a digital cooperative where the users of the platform sort of have autonomy on the platform. They kind of decide what is the best way they want to participate in the mobility economy, in the digital side of mobility economy, and make a better city, a better livable city. So I think those kind of participations, and if you have to get academia, technology entrepreneurs or big players, and along with enabling policymakers. And in that project, I think government just does the enabling policy.
Right.
I think sometimes we expect a lot from government, which probably not the right thing. But even if they can just enable, I think the other four components can come together and create solutions like what we're seeing in that little project in Kochi with the taxi community. So just an example to see how things can do work in future.
Very interesting. Raine, any comments on sort of change in mindset, trying out different things, failing fast, getting academia, industry, government to talk to each other, to move a little more.
I think the big challenge is that we as humans are programmed for here and now. And the sustainability problems, they are far away in time and distance.
Okay.
So, I mean, it's like the election campaign. We discuss what the petrol is costing at the pump. and there's not much discussion about climate or sustainability or anything. It's here and now. So how do we change the mindset in such a way that we actually can include future in our daily decisions?
Very interesting. Eric?
No, I agree. I think we need to collaborate, everyone, to make this change, and it's not something will happen overnight. So let's collaborate in a way we can.
I think it's very simple. Agencies are trying to get larger and larger projects funded because it's easy. Big projects, EU projects, 4 years long, bigger the better, and they push out everything into the project. They should do the contrary. Mm-hmm. They should do small projects. They should set the project leader from the one that's funding. They should set the project leader, and it should be funded for the whole project. Nobody of all the other participants should be the project leader.
Right.
And then the project leader should do all the economy thing, all the shitty thing that the other ones doesn't want to do, and drive the project to the goal.
Fail early, fail fast, right? Oh, Viral, final words? Mindset, do you think it's a mindset issue? Do you think it's, how can we kind of better that?
Yeah, so mindset is definitely an issue. Again, from a big company perspective, we are often risk averse. We struggle to take risks because, you know, failure is not seen in a positive light. Having said that, if we do set our minds to it and are convinced that we need to take some of these bold bets, where some of the bold bets will result in successful outcomes, I think that mindset shift is important to be able to create projects that will be important from a circularity as well as from a climate change perspective.
Very interesting, gentlemen, and we're going to be wrapping up this session, and with that, we'll also be wrapping up Engaging India at Almedalen for this year. Next year, we hope to, of course, get a lot more of our guests from India here physically, if we can. But before that, I would like to call our co-organizers, Professor Emeritus Uwe Ronstrom and Dr. Swaminathan Ramanathan, to wrap up this session and also touch upon some of the issues that we have been talking about even in the previous Engaging India at Almedalen. For example, we have been looking at issues of circularity. We have been looking at, we have been touching upon logom balance, and now we're talking about innovation, failing fast. If this is not complicated enough, I'll throw sort of another challenge under the large umbrella of the world is one family. Go ahead.
Would you like to start?
No, why don't you?
Okay. Well, this is not a very simple issue, is it? Anyway, there are a few takes on this, few insights. I wouldn't call them simple insights, but where to start. We have heard in all these sessions about what also I addressed in the first seminar, that there's a dramatic gap, maybe an increasing gap, between available knowledge and the action that is going on. And this gap is problematic for everybody. We know already enough to start doing it, but we are not doing it as fast as we should or could. That's one of the insights that was from almost everybody. And there is and the other insight is there is actually a whole lot of things going on, and that we heard from a lot of, and more than we would think. We heard from Per-Arne Wikström in India, and that's also a very important insight for Swedes, I think. So, and then yesterday we heard from one of the speakers that I think was a very, very nice catchphrase. We have to do the right things, and we have to do things right. Not only to do the right things, we have to do them right. So get out of the silos is one of the takes, insights from all the speakers. Now, and this comes with several types of problems here. One that I think is super interesting in my point of view is that innovation, we have spoken about innovation a lot on energy, on different types of, from water to energy and to many things. But innovation is, of course, always recognized against the foundation of something that we already know and evaluated against something that we know. This is new, this is innovation. There is something other going on. But innovation in connection to sustainability would be something different, because whatever sustainability is, we don't know what it is.
Mm.
It is unknown territory. So how do we recognize and foster innovation that will take us where we have not been, and where we have never been, and we do know very little about? So innovation about, then we will need innovation of innovation. So we need to innovate our thinking about innovation to get where we will must go, and where we do not know where that is, of course. And the another point here, which is, I think everybody addressed scale. Scale matters. Scale, and I think that it's important to recognize that scale is not the same as size or quantity. Going in between Sweden and India makes us, and thinking with Sweden in an Indian context and with India in a Swedish context makes us highlights the issue of scale. For example, the Spaudi example we heard of last, it was talking about the problems of scaling up and adding things up and things like that. A lot of talk about the scale. I think that it's important to recognize that there's a fundamental difference in everyday world, in the life of the everyday world, which is repetitive, and what we know as the structural world or the systemic or world, which is accumulative. And there is a fundamental difference. So that means scaling up means not, it's not a phenomenon of quantity, but of quality. So we need to rethink the things we're doing when we scale them up. And then to come to maybe the most fundamental insight I got from this seminar is that maybe we spend too much time with innovation on the everyday level, and too little time on innovation on systemic level, on platform level, on the structural levels. Now, we have heard some interesting example from this, from Eric here on the MasterCard, and also from London Nilekenny, which talked about this ID systems. And these are fundamentally different scale than this quality, that scale is a quality and not a quantity, I think is necessary. And that's why innovation needs to be innovated on the level of these big scales. And what Nanda Nilekani added to that also is the importance of working at scale and working with the notion of open commons, digital, in his case, digital publicly open commons. Mm. And that would be a game changer, to work with innovation of innovation on the big scale. So this is what I got from this. And also, to end, collaboration is also a systemic level. What we know is cooperation and collaboration. Even if it's on an everyday basis like here, it works on a systemic level, which is different. So collaboration also needs to be innovated. Which is meta innovative.
Okay.
Yes.
That's a new term. Uwe, perhaps we will use it a little more next year when we are talking about engaging India at Almedalen. Swami, do you want to add?
So I cannot tell you as to how pleased I was to hear Paran talk about India in such terms. And one of the main reasons why we started engaging India at Almedalen in 2019 was to go ahead and get a conversation flowing in which the mental models of both the countries, specifically the mindsets, sort of interact with each other and transform over a period of time. So I think Paran captured it so nicely, and with 3 years of effort. So we want to make it bigger next year. The key takeaways for me was, one is, of course, what Nandan said about digital public goods, and Sujit's also referred to it in his own way. And the ecosystem approach that Viral Neeraj has brought about, and Raine and I, we work very closely, and the way that process-based system model that we've been working on for some time, and it has relevance there. So the idea, the key idea that I'm taking away from it is that people are all the same. they're all looking for solutions. They're all looking for doing something at the ground level. So the intent is there. How do you go ahead and transform and translate that intent into action? And that's where I think that having an open mind and collaborating with two different countries, seemingly different countries, and they're not that different, as I realized when I came to Sweden. So if you get into a Swedish house, for instance, you have to take off your shoes. Now, that's second nature to an Indian. You don't get into someone's house without taking off the shoes. So when you have such kinds of commonalities which aren't really understood, right, but they are shared, then there is a lot more than that can be shared. So the question then is this. Can we develop something which is a common shared tool set, which has methods, which has approaches, which has tools that you can use in different ways, right, in an open manner so that you're co-creating solutions together? So it's more a question of models and tools and tool sets and toolkits. And that's where orchestration and system integration is much more relevant than going ahead and looking at any new invention. I think innovation is about orchestration and system integration. So I'll stop there, and I'll for the next year, just to complicate things further, I'll sort of go ahead and top up what Sujit and Viral have been talking, Viral and Paran have been talking about in terms of the triple helix, and then we've talked about the quadruple helix. I would go ahead and propose what is called as the quintuple helix. Let's also give ecology and environment and voice, right? And let's keep that as a stakeholder. If you have ecology and environment as a stakeholder, then the planet has to have a stakeholder. So we have to start thinking about the health of the planet. So I'll leave it at that point, and then maybe we can pick it up next year. Thank you so much for joining. We've had over 20 panelists from all across Sweden and India joining. So thank you so much, and really appreciate it.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.